Such a joy to be seeing all of you again after the camp. I think I'm coming after the camp for the first time. Anyway, before I come into the message, I thought that I'll share a word in the context of what Rakesh was asking, and I felt that since I'm coming up, I will share it. I just want to read a verse from Acts chapter 4, verse 12. It says that salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. It is the scene, the scenario is after the resurrection after the Pentecost experience. It says in verse 13, when we read, when we saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were too astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. Linking it up with 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27, but God chose the foolish things of this world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. He chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before Him. Somehow I just felt there is a need to share this and to know that there's something which we need to be aware that we have no reason to hold on to the wisdom of this world. And if you connect yourself with Christ, I know you are holding on to something of a higher capacity is being induced into you, and you deprive yourself with Christ, and now you are depriving yourself with great things in your life. I somehow felt that, you know, we should not hold on to. I don't know if it's something coming to someone personally in that context. If you have the tendency of looking and thinking yourself to be wise, the Lord want to remind you, no. The Lord did not choose those who are wise in their own eyes, nor, you know, thought themselves high and esteemed in that measure. God always looked at the things which are despised, things that are lowly. The men who were unschooled and uneducated in many measure, but then they, having connected with Jesus, have transformed their life to a higher plane than they could never be in that realm. So God wanting us to be in that, not to be counting ourselves wise in terms of the rating of the world, but to count ourselves foolish and to be count blessed in the Lord in His ways. Okay, having said that, I will move on to what God has for us this morning. Living God's purpose for His glory. I know we were together in Jan, and even before this year, for the first time, we were together on the New Year Eve, and the message which I shared at the time of the New Year was, let's dream dreams together. Hope you remember that. And I also, we also decided that we must, build on something as a plan for this year. And one of the things which we thought was, you know, we want to be where God's heart is thriving in. And we saw that our God is a missional God, and God expects us, His people, to be missional. And in that context, we thought that we ought to become a missional family. Hope that book is catching dust at home. If not, don't worry, I will make you to revive that. Whenever I come, I'll be touching on that book we will be looking at. So, having said that, let's dream dreams together. It's about living God's purpose for His glory. That's what we are looking at. And this were some of the bullets which we have looked at. God is on a mission in this world. God desires us to partner in His mission. Live out the world intentional. Hope you are not forgotten that word. If you have forgotten, you can tell your neighbor once this morning. Let's be intentional this year. Intentional in all that what we do. Come into your home to be a place for worship, to be a place for relationship, to be a place for outreach, to be a place for mission, and to be a place for discipleship. This is what we want to build on through this year in having. I know this is not a message exclusively for those who are married and set up a home. I would say that all those who are yet to be married and dreaming to be married, I would say this is the dream which you must dream towards, the home which God will enable you to set up. If you dream from now and prepare yourself, and you know, you can align with God, and you know, there will be much happen through your life in that context. You know, this morning I'm going to be on this dream number one, making a home the center for worship. Making a home a center for worship. That's what we want to look at. You know, I have some references which have been put up, but I'm going to be looking at another portion, John chapter 4. John chapter 4, when Jesus met with the Samaritan woman, when it comes to verse 23, say that yet a time is coming and has come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and His worshippers must worship in spirit and in truth. We know that Jesus, when He was here on the earth, one of the disciplines which we can see He has cultivated in His life is to be intimately connected with His Father through worship and through prayer. That is something which He couldn't, you know, avoid, or He couldn't give a second place in His life. That is the first and primary thing which He always looked at. He always wanted to build an intimacy with the Father in such measure. That was, and His functioning is, the flow of things in His life was out of the intimacy and the oneness which He has brought into being through the worship and through the time of prayer He had in His personal life. You know, one of the things which I have got deeply gripped in my heart the moment I, you know, committed my life to the Lord was these two things. One was, I was so, you know, caught up with the aspect of the church. And you know, I keep quoting this verse, Ephesians chapter 3 verse 10. And God's plan and purpose was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God has to be revealed to the principalities and powers on the world outside. And now, you know, it always remains an active thing which ought to happen with the church. I was so moved with that, and I said, Lord, church will ever remain to be one of the deep things which I'll carry and pursue in my life after. When I left the Navy and when I was looking for a job, one of the conditions which I, you know, put before God was, Lord, I want a job which will give me enough free time where I can involve with the church and activities in my life. The second thing which I was so caught up with was about the concept and aspect of a home, a family. Now these two were very close to my heart from the very moment I came to know the Lord, and I know I pursued both, I would say, with all my heart. Pursuing God in fellowship with the people around, in God's family as a church, and also seeking God's wisdom and help in setting up a home where God is honored at all point of time. I definitely wanted my home to be a place. I wanted, Lord, nothing But Lord, when I set up a home, when I have children, Lord, I want to see that my home and my setting is to be something which will bring glory and honor to God. Well, till now, I want to thank God that God is working and God is helping us in that mission. And I just want to praise God for that. But then when we come to the aspect of making a home to be a center for worship, I would say that this has to be the deepest dream which we all dream. All who are called to set up a home, all who will be called to set up a home. And these are the dreams which we must dream, that our home should remain to be a center for worship. You know, many a times when it comes to, you know, worship and activity, we think that, you know, it is for the time when we come together at church. All worship and all prayer and all those things are, you know, exclusively set aside for the church and the, you know, activities related to the church. But then we fail to realize the value that God placed on a home. I always conceived it this way, that when it comes to a home forms the nucleus of God's kingdom. A home, and through a home, much happens for God's purpose and God's glory and for God's kingdom. So in the context of that, if we can see a home to be paramount importance to God, when we see that in the context of what God sees to happen through a home, I would say that that's where things will start change, perspective will be, you know, developed in a new realm, and we see that that is what God looks for, and that is what God's missional heart is, pulsing towards, and we will be able to connect with God in that context. We talk about worship. We talk about this morning time of worship when we come together for worship, and we see major time of our time we spend together, we spend in time in worship. But then sometimes we wonder why do we need to give all the worship, or why do we need to give God all the worship? Worship is worship. Basically, we recognizing God for who He is and bringing the aspect of our life being centered around the very one who has created us for His glory and honor. So, developing a right attitude towards God comes into our life from a right understanding of who God is. A right worship for God comes through a right understanding of who God is. If God and His word are treated without any feelings and awe in our life, then that same thing will be reflected when we worship Him corporately in the church. If we don't have the personal reverence and awe of worship, of connecting with Him on a regular manner, you know, that can't be created only on Sunday morning. It is not that, you know, click a key and say that, no, let's worship together. If we are not practicing it through the week, through the 6 days, in your home, in your own setting, the aspect of worshiping God and honoring God, you can't come here on Sunday morning and suddenly, you know, become holy and lifted up into the heavens and to be connected with God in worship. So when we are talking about worship, it is an aspect we need to develop, and we need to, progress in our life through the days in our life. And then when we come together, the overflow of the expression of worship, when we come together for the combined time celebration, it will be, you know, amazing, and it will be so exciting and edifying for us. If not, it will be like, you know, gashing of cymbals. It will make some noise, and we will never be able to connect with God in that context. A person who has not worshipped God for 6 days cannot worship Him on the seventh day with the right attitude. If we have not developed the attitude to regard God and worship Him through the 6 days of the week, can suddenly can't turn out to become a true worshipper on the seventh day when he comes on Sunday morning. We need to see this is the thing. That is why I would say that, you know, a home being a center for worship, it has to be developed, nurtured, given the due importance. If not, our combined times of togetherness can just make us gnashing of cymbals without making no effect. God will not be glorified in that. So in that context, I say that now our home, going back to the basic, our home has to be the place where we learn to worship God first and foremost. Not, you know, has to be left to a church. Even for our children when it comes to, no, children are going to be Sunday school or children are going to be in the church and they will learn their no. It has to be taught at home. The aspect of prayer, the aspect of worship has to be taught at home. And when we come together as a community to worship, children will also be taught and encouraged to be part of the celebration in that context. One of the strategies of the enemy is to make us believe that since God accepts the way we are, we can make light of His presence. He said, God accepts you. Doesn't matter. God loves you the way you are. Yes, that doesn't make us to make light of His presence. We want to give Him the due regard and awe which He deserves. We should not worship God out of familiarity. We need to get rid of the familiarity spirit. We can never come to God with an ask, Lord, I know you. No, we still don't know Him. We are still knowing Him an increasing measure through our walk with Him. None of us has known God to the fullness as we all need to be. We are growing in our relationship, in our knowledge of Him. And that growth can be fastened up when we put in place those necessary things which are important for our relationship with Him. A family involved in the mission of God must have a right attitude to worship God. We who call ourselves to be the families of God and captured God's heart being missional, I would say that we need to give importance to the attitude of worship to God. Their worship comes out of their deep-rooted relationship and love for God, and their love and longing for God is cultivated through family worship. It has to happen through our family worship. It basically means we are called to be in connectivity, in intimacy with God all the time. Romans 12:1 says, therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, I urge you to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. And there has to be a connectivity with God in our life, every context and every moment in our life. Families who choose to partner with Him in His mission, you know, they always portray the right attitude of worship. If you look at the example of Noah in Genesis chapter 8 verse 20, this is a scenario of the post-flood. We see that the ark is rested on the mountain and he got the clearance that everything is settled, the water receded. And he released the dove, it does not come back. And he knows that it's safe and settled for him to set out. And we read that the first thing they did as a family after the embark of the ark was to worship God. And we read, Noah and his sons were blessed and asked to be fruitful and multiply again. The mission of God to multiply was given to a worshipping family. Having they worship God, God's blessing has come into their life. And He said, God blessed them and said, go and multiply and fill the earth. He repeated that the blessing which He has spoken to Adam and Eve, here again to Noah and his children. Because they have had the attitude to worship God in the context. When we read about Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verse 7 to 8, and verse 13:8 also, what we see is he has developed a right attitude of worship of this great God who has called him through the life. It was not an occasional aspect of worship of this God in Abraham's life. Say that he had, you know, built an altar to God and worshiped God time and again in his life. And it was not done out of duty, but out of expression of spontaneous joy and out of love for God. We know that God is the audience of our worship when we come to worship him. We forget everything else. We forget everyone else who are around us. And we focus on the one, the true source of our life. So our hope, some of the things which we must reflect with regards to making a home to be a center for worship are this. Our hope forms the nucleus of God's kingdom. We need to realize the importance of our home being the nucleus of God's kingdom. God's reign and rule can happen if God is worshipped in a home. Number two, our attitude of worship is cultivated at home. Don't misunderstand me, don't misquote me, but then I want to tell you, don't say that, you know, it is at church I will learn to worship. No, it has to be at your home first. You will come for the celebration of worship when we come together on a Sunday morning, but then it has to be the expression overflow out of your worship which is happening at home. If no worship is happening at home, that's why I said through the 6 days, suddenly in this place when you come on Sunday morning, it can't be made to become out of the ordinary place of worship. It has to be out of our attitude which we are created to worship at home. Home must remain the primary center of worship. When I say home, what about people who are staying in the hostels? Wherever you are staying, I would say that wherever you are staying, wherever God has given you a place to rest and stay, that ought to be the place you consider your home. And that's where I would say that has to be the primary center for worship. A person who has not worshipped, repeating it again, a person who has not worshipped for God, worshipped God for 6 days, cannot worship him on the seventh day with the right attitude. Now, what is going to happen, or what are the benefits of making a home to be a worship center? But having the fact said about all these things, one can know that many a times, the sad fact is that today in many homes, there is no time or there is no place for worship. We are all running the rat race. Time is such a precious commodity that none of us have time. No time for family, no time for husband and wife to sit together and, you know, connect with each other in their life as well. We are so busy, caught up with many things. What are the benefits? What are the benefits of making a home to be a worship center? It will help in passing our faith to our children. Number one, yes, it will help us to grow in the purposes of God. It will help us to grow in our intimacy, in our walk with him. Yes, for sure. But then it also need to know that we need to realize that it also will help us in passing our faith to our children. That is paramount. For every parent, we need to know that God has placed enormous responsibility when it comes to our children. Passing our faith to our children ought to be paramount duty of the parents. Children is not going to learn the faith walk from the neighbor's home or from the church family elsewhere. Our children ought to see the lifestyle which we have created at home. That ought to draw them to this God whom we worship. If we don't create an atmosphere to worship God, how will they ever know this God? How will they ever desire to come to know this God? And because of that, I would say, many a children in the Christian homes are wandering away, are renouncing the faith, and fellowship with the world and heathens outside. It's because there is breaking down of the functional scenario in our homes. There is no worship, there is no authentic faith being transformed or translated into our children being able to capture that from the parents' lifestyle. So if we don't, as husband and wife, if we don't, as parents, live an authentic faith life, what we are depriving of our children is a connectivity with our God from this very early age. We don't need to wait for them to grow and go wander away like the prodigal son and get hit by the storms of life and then get... Who wants that to happen for your own children? I would love to have my child to grow from the very young age in the faith. And my children, our children have made the commitment very young age. When they were not even five, we have been able to lead them to the Lord. We know that they have grown up, they have made their own commitment when they have grown up to a reasonable age in their life. But then that is what we need to. So we must let go of everything else to focus on this aspect of wanting to transfer our faith to our children. They are your spiritual legacy they will carry on with. If we neglect that, you know, running and crying over later stage does not make any sense. So it's time now that we all take this aspect with much seriousness. We must teach and empower our children in our own homes. It is not the Sunday school who has to teach your child about God. It has to be the parents who has to be taught. It is not at the Sunday school our children need to learn about worship, but it has to be at home, in the setting where we are. When we bring in that discipline in our own home, that come, let's pray together, let's worship, let's sing, and you experiment, we'll come back to that. But if you don't create that scenario, we can never expect. Number two, it will help in enhancing our spiritual intimacy. Want to say two more things? The authentic faith in the family, you know, is always contagious. If you as parents, you are husband and wife, is living an authentic faith in your life, I want to tell you that will remain contagious. You can't hide it. People will catch it. Your children will catch it. People will come home, will see what kind of home they are walking into. You know, David, we know that he was a man after God's own heart, and he connected with God through worship and prayer all the time. You know, it's 1 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 11 to 13. I just want to read for us. Chronicles chapter 22 verse 11 to 13. This is David's advice to his son. Now my son, this is to Solomon. Now my son, the Lord be with you, and may you have success and build the house of the Lord your God as he said you would. May the Lord give you discretion and understanding when he puts you in command over Israel, so that you may keep the law of the Lord your God. When you will have success, if you are careful to observe the decrees and the laws that the Lord gave Moses for Israel. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged. You know, this was a passionate encouragement of father speaking to his son. And we know when Solomon took charge and took command from his father and became the king over Israel, the very first thing we read about Solomon he did after becoming a king is that he took all his associates and all the people and traveled a week's time into a place where he put up a camp to worship God, and he offered 1,000 sacrifices unto God, we read. I don't know in the context of quantum of time how much time it would have been needed to offer 1,000 sacrifices, but I know this much: he was the king of Israel. He was in such high position and authority, there could have been many other pressing needs or important things for the king to handle. But then he said, no, let it all wait. The first priority which he was given and he has cultivated in his life was to worship God. I am sure it's also have been like this because of what we have seen of his father. He heard of his father's prayer for him. That made him to take the right decision for his own life and to build on. So when we are talking about times of worship at home, we can, you know, few things that we can create, follow a creative plan. We can encourage each other, personal time with God. We can, you know, children are children. So we need to see that we are reaching to their level deep down as we encourage them, as we help them to discover this God whom we hold of. So be sensitive to the needs of the age groups of the children. Pray with mission of God in mind. Be, you know, when we are at camps, there is times of prayer. When we are at GMI leadership conference, there's always one model of prayer being enhanced to us all the time. The Lord's Prayer, the Elijah model of prayer, and various prayers in that context. You can use family calendar for prayer. Monday we are going to be praying for our own family, inner family, the extended family, the church family, people in need. You can pray for your own city. And these are the ways you will inculcate the aspect of worship and prayer in your own home and your children and for yourself in that context. The second one, as I said, it will help in enhancing our spiritual intimacy. We always call this word, a family that prays together. Little more louder. Yes. A family that prays together stays together. Worship plays the center stage in keeping the family together. If there is prayer and worship at home, and that is a moment of bonding which happens in the home with one another. We must look to family worship also brings accountability to each other and to God. You know, when we come to worship God, we worship a God who knows all things. When you are talking about worship in the family, I would say that it also ought to be a times of vulnerability for us. Be able to share
our inadequacies, our challenges we face through the day. With one another, husband and wife, that would be the right time to open up. We can tell, you know, I was faced with this challenge. And lift up your heart to God in thanking, but how our God has helped me. Let your wife, let your spouse be aware of the challenges we went through. Maybe in a good time to connect with each other in that context as well there. You know, in the times of family worship, it can be the Holy Spirit bringing the conviction about something which you need to confess, maybe in front of the family. Maybe about the strained relationship you have been living it, and then come to the family worship. Could be a time the Holy Spirit help you to, you know, express yourself, to forgive one another, and to be restoring in our own relationship. We know that when Adam and Eve sinned against God, they were afraid to come before God. They went and hid themselves. And they recognized their nakedness as well in those times. In the same way, when we come together for times of worship at home, it could be the time God can expose our nakedness and sins in our own life. The sinfulness of our souls could be exposed when we as a family come into His presence and to allow His word to heal us. When in conflict, coming to God's presence can bear as our souls and brings revelation of our true self in the sight of God, and to bring to a point of reconciliation. You know, there's one man who said like this: family worship is the time that brings me to the conscience my responsibility as a father and a husband. Whenever I come together in our times of family worship, that brings in me the, you know, might bring to my conscience the seriousness I need to carry, the role I'm playing to be a husband and a father, and help me to pull up my socks and correct myself where I'm not right. Third aspect is, it will empower to face crisis and adversity. That is common for our life. Crisis and adversity, every life must be prepared to face. We all go through. Life takes us through twists and turns. Life will bring up surprises which we never expected. Could be a sickness, could be a financial crisis, could be an accident, or could be anything. The loss of a dear one. These are all things to be expected to happen in our own life. We can't insulate our life from tragedies and crises. It will happen. But then how will we pass through those crises could depend on how well we are connected in our family, in worship and in prayer. We must and we will be able to tide over the crisis in our own home and our setting, and we will be able to face the crisis together. We know that, we read the verse, one of us can put 1,000 to flight and two of us can put 10,000 to flight. In a home setting, within the relationship of a husband and a wife being united in prayer and worship and connected to with God, they are such formidable force to be reckoned with. No crisis will become a crisis because God allow the synergy to work in such measure that we are able to face it and go through it, and God will take us through it. Family worship helps in handling crisis in our family life. It helps to handle every situation on a day-to-day basis. Family worship is a time to hear God speak and hear His wise counsel for our own families. We need to seek God's wisdom and guidance for us as a family. How God wants us to partner in His mission. How can we partner with God by being a missional family? Say that when storm comes in our family life, only the home with a strong foundation will stand strong. And there will be storm will come around in every home. And if we are laid strong foundation in our own homes, those storm will not unsettle us in our life. It will help in keeping the appointment with God. You know, one of the things which, when we read Job's life, one regular practice he had was he had an appointment with God on a regular basis. Not only for himself, his time of appointment, he took it as a challenge to pray for his children every day. We don't know. Lord, I seek your forgiveness on behalf of my children. Don't hold anything against them. We don't know where all they are gone today and what all they are involved themselves in. He, as a father, took the ownership for his own children, but he had a regular daily appointment with God. Family worship is an appointment with God. Hello. As I speak, I'm not standing here and preaching this as having practiced it in my life as well. I mean, it's something which I desire and longing. I know we all maybe fall short of this in our own life, but then we all can dream towards a home where there is regular worship happens. But then today, with our hurried lifestyle and varied timings, many families even struggle to meet each other. Husband and wife does not have time because one comes in the morning time after duty, the other one goes for work in the morning, and it's kind of a difficult time. They get to meet each other only on weekend, and there's chores piled up to handle through the day, through the weekend, and we find so exhausted in our own life. If worship is our priority, we may have to order our lives around our time of worship. This story has been told about a young couple. This man was quite ambitious, and he was, you know, wanting to climb the corporate ladder up, and he was running with much pressure of work. He was progressing well in his career, and that was his key. He was quite ambitious. He wanted to make his life count in the corporate sector, and he had no time for his family and children because work has consumed major part of his life. And he says that he was detected to have cancer very early in his life, and he was on his sick bed in the hospital where this couple who has written this book, Sibby and Matthew, has visited him. And he was crying and weeping, and he was confessing, "Now I understand what it means to hold a family together. I was never for my family. I was always with a single agenda of running or growing or going up the ladder in my career. I devoted my life for my career. I never given time for my children and my wife. There were times when my child, 5-year-old child, used to come, 'Daddy, come, let's have time of worship.' I had no time for it." And he says, "Now I understand my career and my job is not the important thing compared to my family and creating a space for my children to capture and to connect with God in their young life." I say that While on my sick bed, now it, you know, drones on my life that it is not my career, but it's my eternity that matters. It is not a bank balance, it's not the pay package which will matter in life ahead. It is where we are going to be spending our eternity. What we are doing here on earth, having received God's call into our life. Some of the reflections which we can look at this morning, reflections and response. As I said, we need to realize God places high value in a home. All those who are married and set up a home, and all those who are dreaming towards that, I want you to understand, God places high value. Much is at stake when it comes to your home which you are building. So because of that, I would say this: develop right attitude towards worship in your home. Take step towards making our faith contagious to our children in our home. Make your faith walk authentic for the children to see it and wanting to follow it. I know there are people who are given themselves to ministry. Their only life is about ministry. They many a time neglect home. God is not looking at your ministry at the expense of your home. If God has called you to a home, that becomes your primary responsibility, not your ministry. Don't be a washing things over. In letting your home friends suffer at the expense of, no, I'm serving God. At that meeting there, that visit there, no. It should not be at the expense of your home. Make family worship an intentional act to achieve oneness and unity in your home, friend. Make family worship an intentional act to achieve oneness and unity. And lastly, make family worship as a time to cultivate the habit of listening to God. Every family, every husband and wife, every parents, we ought to hear God for ourselves. We need to hear God for our family. We need to hear God as to what God wants to see through us as a family, including our children. In becoming a missional family, church, number one dream which we all should dream towards in the days to come is making a home to be a center for worship. All those who are married and all those who are yet to be married, I would say that much is at stake when it comes to God's heart and when it comes to family. Each one of our family is precious. Each of our family is crucial in God's purpose, in God's mission in this world. So let us dream dreams together in seeing and making a home to become a center for worship. Worship of this God ought to be cultivated and nurtured in our own home setting. And that ought to become a contagious thing for our children to capture. And that ought to overflow into our times of worship when we come in our church setting as well. May God help us in building ourselves to be a missional family and dreaming dreams of God to become, to make our home to become a center for worship and honor of this God whom we follow. Shall we just pray? Father, we want to thank you Thank you, Lord, for your kindness and your compassion towards each one of us. That you, in your own love, have drawn us to yourself and put us in your in homes and families where we need to nurture our relationship with you. We acknowledge you are a missional God. You continue to be missional in this world. And we as your children need to capture your heart being missional. I pray this morning for all of us, Lord, that may we capture your heart of being intentional in reaching out to the people around us. And in doing that, Lord, may we cultivate our home to be the nucleus of your kingdom and things to translate and transform in us and out of us through the aspects we build our home with. I pray this morning, Lord, that may our home be the center of worship. May that be the mark of a missional home which we want to build with you, in you. That each one of our homes, those homes which are already existent, and all homes otherwise we are part of, the singles, and the homes which you will indeed increase them and allow them to build in the days to come. May we keep you the first and priority place in our life and our homes by making a home to be a center for worship. And may we honor you through all that what we do in our life and around our life, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.